Welcome to today's Community Cast. My name is Matt Morgan. I'm the pastor at Community Brookside, a new church plant in Tulsa, Oklahoma. We are so blessed by your presence, and we hope that today's content will bring you joy.
So this morning, we are continuing our sermon series, and it's called Under Construction, Building a True and Solid Faith. My sermon title today is When God Closes a Door, He Opens a Window. So we've all heard that before, right? So this morning, I want to invite you to open your Bibles. If you've got a Bible with you this morning, you can open up to the book of Acts, chapter 20. We're going to read verses 7 through 12. I want to remind you that if you don't have a Bible, that's okay. We'll have it on the screen. But I always encourage you, bring your Bibles if you can, underline, make notes, write in the margins. It is awesome when God reveals something to you when you're reading it. And if you don't have a pencil or a pen or something to write it down, you might forget it. So if you can, bring scriptures. If you don't, we've got it for you. So here's what I want to share with you this morning. Hear now the word of the Lord. On the first day of the week, we came together to break bread. Paul spoke to the people, and because he intended to leave the next day, kept on talking till midnight. There were many lamps in the upstairs room where we were meeting. Seated in a window was a young man named Eutychus, who was sinking into a deep sleep as Paul talked on and on. When he was sound asleep, he fell to the ground from the third story and was picked up dead. Paul went down, threw himself on the young man, and put his arms around him. "Don't be alarmed," he said. "He's alive." Then he went upstairs again and broke bread and ate. After talking until daylight, he left. The people took the young man home alive and were greatly comforted. Amen. So, listen, I could pull a Paul today, but I'm not going to do that. You guys will get out roughly on time. But I want us to take a second and kind of recap what we've talked about the last couple of weeks. So we're talking about this, as you can see here, we're talking about construction, we're talking about buildings. 2 weeks ago, we talked about how the foundation of our faith is found in Christ, and we can only find that foundation in Jesus when we read the scriptures. And the scriptures are also the foundation of our Christian creeds, which kind of are this encapsulation of what we fully believe about who Jesus is, who God is, how the Holy Spirit impacts us, and all the basics of who we are as believers in Jesus. And then last week, we talked about framing our lives on the example of Jesus by reading about Jesus' life and then living our lives in response to who Jesus is. We talked a lot last week about blueprints, how a house should look, or what, you know, things it includes, how there are intricate details and measurements that are a part of a set of plans that are used to show builders and craftsmen exactly how a building or home should be built. And one of the things we didn't talk a whole lot last week about was that in these plans are often included windows and doors. And in the scripture we just read, there's a pretty interesting moment that we don't get to see too often in scripture, right? It's a resurrection from the dead, and the only thing that makes it possible is the fact that there's a window on the third floor of this building. Paul raised a man from the dead, and he did this after literally preaching him to death, right? Put this poor guy to sleep, and he fell from the third floor and dies. Have you guys ever seen a building without windows before? Like a big building or a house without windows? It's pretty odd, isn't it? So this is a building that's in New York. What you see at the top there are not windows. Those are ventilation ducts. There is not one window in this whole building except on the ground floor as you enter into it. It's a very unique building that is in New York. This here is in Hershey, Pennsylvania. This in 1938, was it 38? I think it was 38. Yes, this building was built in 1938, and this is the modernist building in the world at this point. Everything inside this building was artificially controlled, from the lighting to the air, and not one single window in this building because they thought that people would be much more productive if they couldn't see outside. This is another building in New York City. This is where they store 5,000 tons of salt. They've created this building with no windows, so you don't know what's in it. On the backside, there's two giant garage doors that open if there's a snowstorm, and this is where New York City gets their salt from to salt their roads. buildings look interesting when they don't have windows, right? This is a building in China. This is an apartment building with not one window. It's cool, yeah. Cold. Oh, cruel. Cruel. And look at this house. So the interesting thing about this is that this is actually an art installation. This is not a real picture of a house. Actually, let me rephrase that. It is a picture of a real house, but they have painted bricks over the windows. This was an artist kind of conversation about privacy and how in the century that we live in, we don't have much of it. I got a chance to study a little bit about windows this week. Do you remember when windows were invented? Yeah, nobody does, right? So windows were kind of this thing that have been around since humans began to build permanent homes, when they moved out of caves and instead began to build homes out of mud and sticks and bricks and rocks and things like that. And they built these windows in order to be able to see from the inside to the outside. Some windows were built to protect people from elements and from flying weapons and arrows even. Many people covered the openings that they had made in their homes with curtains made out of things like oil-soaked animal hides, animal furs, cloth, wood blocks, and sometimes paper. As technology began to evolve, people created more effective coverings for windows. For example, the ancient Greeks were the first to use wooden plantation-style shutters to cover their windows as a way to protect the people who were inside. The Romans were among the first to use glass in architecture, though their glass was very different from the glass that we recognize today. Around 100 AD, artisans in Roman Egypt experimented by adding manganese oxide, right, to their glass mixtures. While this addition produced transparent glass, it wasn't perfectly clear like the glass that we see today. One of my favorite things is going to an older home and seeing that leaded glass, right? You can see the waves and the bubbles in it. Although the medieval Scandinavians weren't the first to come up with windows, they were the people who named what a window would be called. The origin of the word window is thought to be an old Norse word called vindauga, which translates to wind. For centuries, glass windows were too expensive to install in homes unless you were from a very wealthy aristocratic family. But the majority of the population were actually illiterate up until relatively recent times. And the only place most people encountered windows would have been a place like a public library or a church. Because people were illiterate, artisans would create these dramatic stained glass panels depicting stories and symbols from the Bible, and these windows would serve as learning tools and inspiration, encouraging people who couldn't read Scripture to pursue a holy and prayerful life. There was a time in history when European governments wanted to figure out a way to tax people, right? As, you know, governments do. And they didn't want to put like a general income tax on people because they thought that would be unfair to the poorest of their residents. So instead, they put taxes on things that only rich people could afford. And eventually, in the year 1696, they created a window tax. And it taxed citizens based on the number of windows that they had. It was interesting. In that time, you would think people would go, you know what? I've got this beautiful house. I've got this idea to put all these windows in it because it becomes exterior light for folks in these homes, right? The only way that they had light in those days was through candles or burning oil inside the house once it got dark. But the more windows they had, they were going to be taxed more. You would think they would go, okay, well, I'm going to scale down my number of windows. But the wealthy during this period of time put even more windows in to express how wealthy they were. I'm not afraid of a tax. I'll put in all the windows, right? But on the other hand, to avoid paying taxes, some landlords decided they would board up or forego putting windows in buildings for the people who lived in their tenements. This tax actually remained in effect in some European countries until 1851, when legislators repealed it in order to improve public health. As a result of the Gothic revival of Art Nouveau movements, stained glass windows became a common fixture, not just in churches, but also in Victorian homes and businesses. Some Victorian-era houses still have their original 19th century windows, right? I think some of us have seen some of those on the East Coast. When we continue to talk about this metaphor of building as our theme for our sermon series, how do you think that windows and doors represent different aspects of our faith? Have you ever thought about that at all? Probably not. Nobody's like, oh, I've never really compared my faith to a construction site or a building plan or a window or a door. But do you think you can find a relation between a window and a door in a building to something of faith? Windows and doors in a building are openings in a building through which the outside world can be seen and experienced. So when I think about windows and doors from a spiritual perspective, I think about intentional places where the spiritual world and the world kind of have this space where they can come together. When we frame a house, it often includes creating openings for windows and doors, which allow light to enter and provide a view of the outside world. Properly framed windows are essential for both the aesthetics and functionality of a building. Doors, on the other hand, are openings in a building that allow passage from the inside to the out and from the outside in. It's through a door that we enter into a place. We cross a threshold and become guests. Windows and doors for us act as connecting points between the inside and the outside of our comfortable places. I don't know about you guys, but one of my favorite things to do during a thunderstorm is to crack open the blinds and look outside, right? To see the lightning and the thunder. And if you're from Oklahoma, which many of us are, oftentimes during a thunderstorm, we don't just open the windows, we step outside on the front porch, right? Like, we have to be fully invested in what's happening around us. Sometimes for us, windows and doors can become an experience all their own. And when we speak spiritually about these openings, these windows and doors, I think of these as places in our spiritual lives where we as believers in Jesus can connect with people who are on the outside of spirituality. As a reminder, none of us live in a silo, right? We all interact daily with different places in our lives where we might run into people who don't believe in Jesus. School, work, we encounter people who either aren't believers or sometimes are even hostile to the Christian faith, because often we've done a pretty bad job of representing what happens inside these doors, outside these walls. But I believe that in our spiritual lives, we are called to find connecting points as ways to invite people from the outside to become insiders. As we work to build a stronger and more Christ-centered faith, we need these spiritual windows and doors so that we can connect with people who need to know more about Jesus. So there's this beautiful scripture where Jesus says, you know what? You guys got it. Disciples, you guys, you got it. You've been with me for now almost 3 years. I want you to go and be uncomfortable for a minute. In the book of Luke, chapter 9, verses 1 through 6, Scripture tells us this. When Jesus had called the 12 together, he gave them power and authority to drive out all demons and to cure diseases. And he sent them out to proclaim that the kingdom of God and to heal the sick. He told them, take nothing on the journey, no staff, no bag, no bread, no money, no extra shirt. Whatever house you enter, stay there until you leave that town. If people do not welcome you, leave their town and shake the dust off your feet as a testimony against them. So they set out and went from village to village, proclaiming the good news and healing people everywhere. When we talk about this in a spiritual sense, oftentimes we think that the church has to be this separated, segmented thing that is separate from the world. And oftentimes it gets us in trouble because Jesus sets the example. Once you get it, you got to go. He sends his disciples out of their comfort zone, out of places that they've known, and he sends them into the world and says, there are going to be people who treat you hostily. And when that happens, shake the dust off your shoes as a testimony against these people. Jesus invited the disciples to share their experience with the people who were outside of their normal life experiences. And the weird thing is that we look at scripture where Jesus sends out his disciples, and sometimes we get confused. Do you recognize that there's a lot of bad theology in the world? Can everybody give me an amen on that one? So there's a lot of bad theology in the world. And I remember that when I was a young person, I had a youth pastor who reminded me, Matt, you know, scripture calls you to not be unequally yoked. Therefore, you should not have friends who are not believers. You ever heard that before? As I was a young person, I was very much in the belief that that was true, that I should not be unequally yoked. I shouldn't have friends who are not Christians. I should surround myself with people who were just like me, who followed Jesus, who wanted Jesus, who, you know, strived after the lifestyle that Jesus promoted. But Jesus sends his disciples out into the world to share what they knew about the kingdom of God with people who were others. They took an opportunity to step outside their safe places so that they could begin to change people's lives. The theology kind of makes sense. Like my youth pastor used to tell us, well, we can't be polluted or corrupted by the world. But if we're unwilling to be with people who are sinners, if we're unwilling to be with people who are different from us, it's not that we keep ourselves from being corrupted, it's that we don't set the example of what faith should be for our brothers and sisters who need Jesus. If we're not careful, we might practice this kind of sort of exclusionist theology that some preachers talk about. Instead of being the people that Jesus called us to be by inviting others to come to the inside. Since the earliest times, it seems there has always been this idea of us versus them, right? But part of what Jesus did was he cut a hole in that wall that was built between the Jews and the Gentiles. Cut a hole in the wall that was placed between those who were able to practice their faith as Jewish people and those who might have been considered unclean. Jesus, through his conversations with Samaritans, through his loving of Roman centurions and their families, through his invitation of children to come and take part in his ministry, in all these ways and in so many more, Jesus created places where the insiders and outsiders could experience God together in new ways. The Apostle Paul writes about it this way in the book of Ephesians, in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 11 through 22. He says, therefore, remember that you formerly, you who were Gentiles by birth and called uncircumcised by those who call themselves the circumcision, which is done in the body by human hands, remember that at that time you were separate from Christ, excluded from citizenship in Israel, and foreigners to the covenants of the promise, without hope and without God in the world. But now In Christ Jesus, you who once were far away have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made the two groups one and has destroyed the barrier. For he himself is our peace, who has made the two groups one and has destroyed the barrier, the dividing wall of hostility, by setting aside in his flesh the law with his commandments and regulations. His purpose was to create in himself one new humanity out of the two, thus making peace. He came and he preached peace to you who were far away and peace to those who were near. For through him, we both have access to the Father by one Spirit. Consequently, you are no longer foreigners and strangers, but fellow citizens with God's people and also members of his household, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the chief cornerstone. In him, the whole building is joined together and rises to become a holy temple in the Lord. And in him, you too are being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by his Spirit. Jews and Gentiles can participate fully in the kingdom of God together for the first time. Sinners and saints alike are invited in the same way to be a part of what God wants to do in this world. From this point on, Paul says there's no favoritism over those who were the insiders. Through Jesus Christ, we've created this togetherness that before has never been. The conversation about keeping ourselves separate from those people should be over. Christ called each of us to be witnesses to them through the power and the love of God. And we cannot witness to people outside of our walls if we are unwilling to be among them. Jesus created a place where we as believers have this beautiful door that we can step out of and into the world. And we are expected as people of Jesus to step through these windows and doors of faith as a way to love people who are different from us. And we're called to follow Christ's example. In 1 Corinthians 9, 19 through 27, it says this, "Though I am free and I belong to no one, I have made myself a slave to everyone to win as many as possible. To the Jews, I became like a Jew to win the Jews. To those under the law, I became like one under the law, though I myself am not under the law, so as to win those under the law. To those not having the law, I became like one not having the law, though I am not free from God's law, but I'm under Christ's law, so as to win those not having the law. To the weak, I became weak to win the weak. I have become all things to all people, so that by all possible means I might save some. I do this all for the sake of the gospel, that I may share in its blessings. Do you not know that in a race all runners run, but only one gets the prize? Run in such a way as to get the prize. Everyone who competes in the games goes into strict training. They do it to get a crown that will not last, but we do it to get a crown that will last forever. Therefore, I do not run like someone running aimlessly. I do not fight like a boxer beating the air. No, I strike a blow to my body and make it my slave, so that after I have preached to others, I myself will not be disqualified for the prize." Each of us is called to be witnesses to the world. And Paul tells us that we are called to do whatever it takes in order to do it. And one of the ways, friends, that your church has done that this week, one of the ways that we have become witnesses to the world, is by becoming carpenters and laborers. Friends, this is what we did this week. That house right there before this picture was awful. Osha, am I right that this is the house that down here was like, there was a hole? There was a hole that literally you could put your hand from the outside into. And so none of these kids are trained to be carpenters. None of these young people are trained to be siding specialists. None of them knew what they were doing when they showed up on the site this week, but they got to be something they were not in order to share the gospel. This was me on the roof with a bunch of high school graduates. Some of them were college students. Here's some of your boys acting crazy, and that is, in fact, Price on top of Isaac. They got to rehab houses this week in a way that changed the lives of the people who lived inside them. Again, this house that I was working on did not have a single vent in the roof, and when you stepped on the roof, it was so incredibly wavy. And so we got to find a way to fix that by putting some vents in their roof. Here are some of the other sites that our kids were on doing siding. There's Carter looking cool on a deck that he helped build. So not only did they side that house perfectly, I mean, that is a beautiful home, but they built that deck from scratch. By the way, they might have accidentally broken the water mains in order to do that. Here's my roofing crew. All of them are young people. Not one of them had ever been on a roof before. Not one. Some more of our kids and Othia. By the way, it was incredible for us to have such great representation, not just in the form of students, but also from our adults. Some of our girls, AJ and Izzy. OSHA taking photos with some of the kids on her group. You guys, you put that in upside down.
Yeah.
I am so impressed that these kids were willing to do what it takes to show the love of Jesus. They became like people they weren't in order to express to these people the love of Jesus Christ. Some of these kids are kids we don't know from other parts of the state, from other churches, who were willing to do the same thing. There's our kids preparing for worship. There's Erica. Where is she? She's not even in here. These kids stretch themselves to do great things in the name of Jesus. Oh, and I was wearing my Captain America shirt, and they're like, hey, you should pretend that's a shield. So that's me being a dork. Those kids were awesome. Our kids and our adults stepped out of their comfort zone this week. They put themselves in tool belts, and they went to work to re-roof houses, to provide wheelchair ramps, to insulate inside houses that were in desperate need of repair, so desperate that many of these houses required some incredible structural work to make sure that siding could stick to the sides of the homes. And we did this in order to show people that following Jesus means that we literally love our neighbors. This week, our young people became roofers and siders and painters and carpenters and so much more in order to convince some that Jesus changes lives. And friends, that's what we're called to do every single day. We are called to step out of this building and out of this room and go into a world that is broken and hurting and needs to know who Jesus is. And if we're not willing to do it, I promise you, no one else is. Sometimes we're going to have to forsake our own comfort in order to prove the love of Jesus to others who sometimes hear the words, oh, Jesus loves you, but they've never experienced it from people who say they follow Jesus. Friends, we are called to be a blessing to people no matter where we are in every chance we can. So when we think about windows and doors, windows become this way that we can shine the light of Jesus through our lives. Windows serve as a reminder also that our lives are transparent. We can't hide our sin from God. God recognizes when we make mistakes, but God is always willing to forgive us. Doors remind us that they serve as a way for us to be invitational. I remember the first time I walked into the doors of a church years ago. The doors were huge. These were 9-foot-tall doors. They were made out of like 2x6s, like nailed and glued together. It was the heaviest door I ever opened in my life. And there was nobody at that front door of this church. I had to open the door by myself and invite myself in. I don't want us to be that kind of church. I want us to be the kind of church that has somebody at the front door with a smile who is welcoming, excited that people are there. People should never have to open the door on their own. They should be invited in, and we should be the people who are holding it wide open so that people can come in and see what's happening in the life of our church. Doors and windows become a way that, just like in the springtime when the weather begins to change, we can open a window, we can open a door, and we get this beautiful breeze that kind of flows in and out of the house. We need to be people who understand what's going on around us in the world so that we can respond, and then we can be a breath of fresh air to the people outside in the world as well. I know this is a big jump metaphorically, but I also know it's important for us not to build these giant walls with these stained glass windows that become dividers between us and them. The church has to be us and them in order to bring about the kingdom of God that God invites us to be a part of here and now. So friends, this week I'm inviting you to be a window into the life of faith. I'm inviting you to be a door that is invitational, that invites people to come with you, to come into a church that wants to love them and encourage them. It takes all of us to make a difference in the lives of those who are outside of these walls. And if we're not doing our job correctly, those people will always be outsiders when Christ invites them to be insiders too. So this week, friends, be a window of faith to somebody. Let's pray.
Thank you so much for joining us on today's Community Cast. We hope that you were blessed by today's conversation. If you'd like to know more about Community Brookside, please feel free to visit us at our website, communitybrookside.com, or find us on your favorite social media outlet. We hope to hear from you soon. Be blessed.